you founded this venture. You started with the Moscow Times and later introduced around 30 other Western magazines such as Cosmopolitan, Playboy, and Vogue. Now, Russia has commercial media. What type of entrepreneurial characteristics does it require to do this?
Well, in my case, how does this work? First of all, I'm a journalist. I'm not a businessman. I think that it's the best motive to do something in life, that you are passionate about what you want to do. I never started the business to be a businessman. I started the business because I wanted to have a newspaper. I like newspapers, I like magazines, and it seemed like a wonderful kick every morning to go to the mailbox and to pick up your own newspaper from the mailbox. That was like a child's dream. And in Russia, I saw the opportunity to realize that. And I think, I've never thought about business. I have no education whatsoever. I've never studied anything. I just wanted to be a journalist. So I think the most important is that you're passionate about something. You know, whether it's, in my case, it's newspapers, and you know, someone else may want to do something in art or in movies or doesn't matter, or sports, as long as you really want to, you know, do something.
Okay. A lot of people will be fascinated to know where you, Dirk Sauer, actually come from. You were born in 1952 in Amstelveen.
I was born in Amsterdam. Just very 5 minutes from here.
Okay. Even closer.
Right.
And what sort of upbringing did you have? What were your parents like?
I come from a typical Dutch middle class family. My father was the chairman, director of a pension fund, a big pension fund in Holland. My mother was a lawyer. My brothers all went to university. But I grew up, I'm a product of the Vietnam generation. So I grew up in the 60s and 60s. And when I was 14, I joined the Marxist-Leninist Party, the MLCN, which later became the Socialist Party, SP, what is now called as the SP. I'm one of the founders of the SP. I went always to the Vietnam demonstrations and later, the Krag movement. And so, I'm a typical product of the 60s and 70s.
Yeah, I even read that you at some point went to Northern Ireland with the IRA and you were in the midst of, in the midst of guerrilla wars. What was going on with you at this time? Were you like a rebel, was looking for excitement or?
Yeah, I mean, I was 18 and I wanted to join the liberation struggle in the world. At that time, people were very idealistic. Unfortunately, students these days are not very idealistic. They just want to make money. But at that time, the student, it was a very interesting time. And I just wanted to join the revolution. And the closest by was Ireland, Northern Ireland. It was, the cheapest to go to because, I didn't have money to go to South America or Africa. But Northern Ireland was only 1 hour from here, and there was a liberation struggle going on there. And I just went there. I did not know anybody, but I just went to the office of the Civil Rights Movement, and I said, "Hi, I'm Dirk, and I want to help you." And then I started living in the house of what turned out to be the local commander of the Irish Republican Army. I became a little bit part of the IRA and saw everything from close by.
And this was at the age of
18.
So you were at the age of 18, you were already living on life on the edge.
Life on the edge. It was just very interesting to see that. Also, it was very, of course, I learned a lot of lessons immediately. Because when I came there, it was all very idealistic. And people were, you know, fighting for the Catholic minority. And, you know, there was a very good reason to fight. But I saw very quickly how violence, you know, those liberation movements, how they got corrupted, how it became, you know, first it was about politics, then it was about money, it was about power, later it was about drugs, it was about business. You know, the revolution became a business. And I've seen it everywhere. You know, I've been in, after that I became a war correspondent. So I've been in every single war that was fought in the 70s. You know, Zimbabwe or Latin America or Chile or Africa. And every time when you saw those people and you interviewed them when they were guerrilla leaders, they seemed great people, you know, very idealistic. Once they were in power, they became the most corrupt, unpleasant people. Like Mugabe, I've interviewed Mugabe many times before he became president. Well, you know now he's one of the most brutal, unpleasant people in the world.
But that happens with everyone?
I think it happens with everyone. Once you are in a position of unchallenged power, it is almost impossible to stay normal. Only very few people, maybe Nelson Mandela is an example, you know, that's why he's so, you know, such a big guy, you know. But very, very few people can deal with it, you know.
Deal with the power.
Can deal with power, can remain normal when they're in such a position.
How do you deal with it?
Well, first of all, I don't have power.
Some would disagree with it.
And you know, I think you should stay close to yourself, you know. And I started out as a revolutionary. I wanted to change the world. Over time, I became more of a journalist because what I see is that in every society where there is no free press, things go wrong. Because then power cannot be challenged. One of the big problems in Russia. But whether it's Russia or any other society where there's no free press, you can bet it's corrupt, you can bet human rights are violated, the economy in the end is not functioning well because of the corruption. And so that's why I became such a passionate journalist. Because I think journalism is one of the most key functions in a normal society.
So if I understand correctly, you see that you help the world by giving journalism a greater chance in some parts of the world, in this example Russia, because then the power is challenged.
Exactly. Because when you have free journalism, then you can challenge people in power, and as I said before, people in power only stay normal if they are challenged. That is why every person in power always tries to kill journalism, you know, because they, you know, we irritate them, you know. But this is exactly what is needed. If you don't irritate people in power, then, you know, then they lose touch. You know, they lose, even if they are good people. You know, I don't think these people are inherent bad people. I don't think Mugabe, who now is a horrible person, is born as a horrible person. You see, he became it because he got the opportunity to become a horrible person.
So how does this process work, according to you, that people like turning to horrible people?
Well, you see, for instance, you know, I know Putin quite well.
If you say you know him, how?
Well, you know, I've met him several times in person. You know, he's not my friend. Thank God he's not my friend. Because, you know, we irritate him a lot. But I've met him several times. I know a lot of people around him. And when he came, same thing, when he became a president, in the beginning he was actually quite good. You know, he had a lot of ideals of how to change Russia. It was at that time very corrupt and very chaotic after the Yeltsin years. And, you know, the first 2-3 years, everything seemed fine. And Russia was making a lot of progress, a lot of reform, economic, legal. But then he also got this power bug, you know, this infected by power, you know. And, you know, because there's so much money in Russia, you know, all these billions of dollars from the oil and the gas and the wood and the diamonds and what have you. And it's so tempting to want to take that money. And then once you take it, you want to keep it. And once you are sitting in, you know, in this isolated bubble, because that's what you, when you become a really powerful person, you don't know anymore how normal people live. You forget about it, you know. You don't know that there are traffic jams in Moscow, or that there are a lot of poor people. Or, you know, you never see them, you know. I was just talking 2 weeks ago to the Minister of Transport in Russia. And they, after many, many years, they finally built a railway between the center and the airport. Russia has the most backward airport in the world. I mean, the airport in Sudan is better than in Moscow. They finally built a train, which is great. The Minister of Transport had no idea
that it was being built.
That there was a train. He just didn't know. You know, because of course he never goes to the airport because he has a private plane and there's a special airport for high government officials. So when I asked him, I told him, you know, I'm so happy with the new train. He looked at me, what is this guy talking about? You know, people in power lose sense of reality, and the bigger the power is, the more disattached they are to the reality.
But if we see that, or if we assume that in the beginning Putin's ideas and intentions were good, and also were his people around him, they were former KGB people, if I'm correct.
Yeah, yeah.
So how, but they not necessarily have a reputation of being the good.
The fun thing is the KGB people in Russia were the big drivers behind the change in Russia, because they were the people who went to spy in the West. They, you know, Putin lived in Germany. Other people lived in America, in London, and so on. They saw that, you know, life could be better. They came back to Russia, and there's, you know, what a mess it's here. They could compare. So, of course, KGB has done a lot of terrible things, but actually the foreign spies, and Putin is one of them, were the more intellectual part of the Soviet system.
So if you already said that Putin also was tempted to gain a lot of money, so how did he do this?
Well, what they did in Russia is that the government, the civil servants, they nationalized the state. So here a civil servant is supposed to work for the state. There they are, it's a business. You know, from very small to very big. Like, I live in Moscow. If I want to have water, I have to go to the water utility. And then I have to bribe the guy to give me water. Because this is how he makes money. If I want electricity, same thing. If, you know, if the tax people come to our office, they tell you, they don't check your books, what normally tax people do, but they just tell you, you know, we don't have time to check your books, but we want $1 million from you.
That's a different way of business.
That's easily paid by you, $1 million?
Well, it's not easily paid, but you have no choice.
Right. So you pay every year $1 million?
Well, you know, you negotiate. It's a business. You know, in business, you negotiate. You know,
so, half a
million. Well, you try, you know. So the state has become a business. It's also the policemen on the street. You know, they stop you and they want you to pay a fine. It's just that's the way they make money.
Somehow you adapt to the system. That's basically
what you learn your business. You learn to adapt to the system, of course. You know.
If we take it a little bit more back to you.
But what I'm saying is, so Putin, when he came in, he said he would change all that. But the interesting thing is that now Russia is much more corrupt than it was before Putin.
Yeah.
And I mean, the corruption has an incredible level now. And that is because there's no free press to challenge that. You know, we are the
only... where you come in.
We are the only... We have two newspapers. There are three newspapers left in Russia who write about these issues.
So I've got one last question on Putin. I never read that he, like, took away, like, billions of dollars and put it somewhere on the Bahamas or anything. But he did do that? Or?
Well, I don't... You know, I cannot show you his bank accounts. But,
we can...
He has a house in Italy.
He has a house in Italy, next to Berlusconi.
Yes.
All right,
maybe he has more houses than in Italy.
But you know, a good friend of mine is a lawyer at Gazprom. Mm-hmm. He's my best Russian friend. You know, very nice guy. He's a lawyer at Gazprom, which is the state gas company. He has a private plane. He has houses in Gstaad, in Sardinia, in London, in God knows where. I mean, how can you pay that on just the normal salary of a lawyer?
Yeah.
And that is how all these people live, you know? Where the money comes from, I don't know. I mean, well, I know,
you
but,
know.
You know.
Okay, we take it back a little bit more to you. At the age of 29, so we're back to the little bit more historic events, you became the chief editor of Nieuwe Revue, which is a magazine in the Netherlands. One of the employees at this magazine, Gerrit Mollema, has said about you that you always like to be a leader and that you were a perfect team player in the weekly brainstorm sessions. Do you believe you were a good leader at the time? And what has brought you success?
People say, very often, sometimes they say I'm a good leader, but you know, I think what my strength is, and I think that is the most important for leadership, is that I don't know a lot of things very well. I'm not a good writer. I'm not really a good journalist. I'm not a good musician. I'm not very good at anything. I'm serious. But what I'm good at is to spot talent in other people. What I like to do is to find the best people and work together with them, you know, make a team out of them. So I see myself as like a football coach. I'm the coach, but the guys on the field, you know, my managers, my editors, my salespeople, they are the stars. And what I do is I try to get the best team on the field. So I don't work. I don't like working. And I don't work hard. I don't go to the office a lot. I come in at 12 and I go away at 5. I like to do yoga. I'm a big yoga fan. And the only thing I do in my life is find the best people.
So that is your greatest strength, so to speak.
Right.
So, okay, and after 7 years of being chief editor at this magazine, you find a new challenge. Feinu asks you to launch a magazine in Moscow in 98. Was the journey to Russia, was that at that time, was it like a reflection of the young Derek Sauer who was looking for excitement, who was a rebel, wanted to change the world?
Well, that was the moment of perestroika and glasnost. Gorbachev, you know, was in power. It was the most exciting place to be in the world. You know, it was so historic what happened there. Because this huge empire came crashing down, you know. It was a huge mess. When we arrived there, there were no shops, there was no food. You had to stand in line up, you know, at 3 a.m. to get some petrol. It was fascinating. So, of course, you know, when people ask you, do you want to go there, you know, you must be stupid to say no.
Okay. You know? How about your wife? Or you didn't have a wife? You
know? I have a wife. And
yeah,
so
you do now.
I have a wife. In fact, next week we are 25 years married.
Congratulations.
So, but she's also, she's a journalist too. That helped. And she became... Actually, she is very famous in Russia. She's much more well-known than I am because she started a magazine called Cosmopolitan, which now is the biggest magazine in Europe with a circulation of 1 million. And Cosmopolitan is so famous in Russia. Everyone knows Cosmopolitan.
Do you think that Cosmopolitan is like good journalism?
Yeah, I actually think so. I think Cosmopolitan is extremely important. We have thousands and thousands of letters, and now of course it's all through the internet. We have the biggest women's website in Russia, where women talk about their life before and after Cosmo. Because Cosmopolitan has put a lot of issues on the agenda.
What kind of issues?
Well, you know, in the old days in the Soviet Union, people, you know, women were very second-class citizens. You know, they had to do all the hard work, you know, the road building and the construction, but they had to shut up, you know. And Russian men are all, they all drink. They all, you know, they are drunk half of the time. They beat up their wives. The average Russian woman has 10 abortions.
Wow.
Yes.
During her whole life.
Abortions, you know. So, and Cosmopolitan was the first magazine to put those things really on the agenda. And, you know, we have many women, you know, because we tour the country with Cosmopolitan, with show, and then girls come up to me and say, thank you so much, I kicked out my husband. You know, I stopped doing abortions, you know. I now go for my own career. And we have a company, we have more than 1,000 people working in our company, Independent Media, and it's 800 women. And women in Russia are very smart, and men in Russia are very stupid.
All right, so you would recommend a Russian wife?
Well, you know, there's so many beautiful Russian women, but you know, I already have a wife, so and I'm very happy. So.
Okay.
But I would, if you can choose, you know, choose a Russian wife.
So the magazine Filled, the first one, so not the Cosmopolitan, but the Moscow magazine, if I remember correctly. And the communism fell. So it's 91, there's a coup against the government of Mikhail Gorbachev. And just 1 year later, 92, you started Independent Media, but you even sold your house to start this newspaper in the midst of crisis. What were you thinking?
Well, I was thinking, well, I think the most important is not to think too much, you know. I had no money. We had a beautiful house in the Pese Hofstraat in Hof. I don't know if you know the Pese Hofstraat, but we started this newspaper, and of course it lost money. You know, we made a business plan. It was a stupid business plan, and you know, we thought we would make money, but we lost money, and we did not have a choice. It's either go for it, sell everything you have, and just, you know, go all the way, or stop it, you know, and go back to Holland and do back to a boring life, basically, you know.
Wasn't it scary to give up everything for an adventure?
No, that's adventure, you know, it's because I didn't do it for the money. I'm not interested in money, you know. Of course, if I can make money, great, but it's not the motive. And people live by fear, especially in our type of societies. We don't do a lot of things because we are afraid. We are afraid to lose our money, or to lose friendship, or to lose a wife, or to lose whatever. But what is important in life is that you don't do things by fear, but you do things out of love, of passion, or whatever you call it, out of your heart. And then everything will be okay. And whether you're rich or poor, yeah, you just as long as you can eat.
That sounds really beautiful. And although maybe in Holland, it's fear. I think it sounds really beautiful. But in Holland, maybe the fear is not grounded. Well, in Russia at that time in 92, when the communism fell and so many people were killed, actually there is a sense of fear that it is logic, and to go there and to give up everything to be there around all these killings and start something there, that I imagine that must be really scary.
No, it was exciting, it was interesting, and it was, I liked the people that I worked with. I saw these young people that for the, you know, their parents had been oppressed, you know. They all had a story about a family member a mother, an uncle, you know, disappeared in the gulags. They all had a story about poverty. They had nothing. In the beginning, we did not pay people with money. We paid people with food. Because there was nothing to buy. We shipped in food from Holland. So, but these young people were so excited about the possibilities they had. You know, they were so motivated to do something new. And you know, that is what I sometimes miss here in Holland, you know, this excitement. You know, here it's all, you know, well, it's, you know, people are
superficial.
They're not superficial, but they look at it from a negative point of view, you know. In Russia, what I like about it, if you do something, then people appreciate it, you know, they like it. They, the people in my, you know, we don't have working hours at our office. I have this company now for 10 years. I don't have people who are sick. Well, sometimes they have a flu or something, but you know, overspannen, people who are just stressed out, you know. Or people with this disease, how do we call it? We haven't even heard of it, you know. I mean, and it is because people have, for the first time they can go somewhere, you know. And then I saw them, you know, for the first time they could travel. For the first time they could, you know, do other things, you know, which their parents couldn't do. It's very exciting to live among those people.
That's beautiful, but a lot of people in Russia can't do what their parents did because they're a lot poorer than their parents in the communism.
No, come on. People are so much richer now.
Is it?
Oh, incomparable. You know, I mean, Moscow, Amsterdam is a poor village compared to Moscow.
For some, but Russia
no, not for some. That's the biggest misconception. What you read in the newspapers here. You know, hey, there's of course a group of billionaires, outrageously rich people, but in Russia there's a huge group of middle class people. You know, Moscow has the four biggest IKEAs in the world, and I tell you, IKEA is not for rich people. You know, if you come there on a Saturday, it's like wow. You know,
you go to IKEA.
Well, only because my wife forces me to go there, but sometimes I go there. And I, you know, I'm always like shocked, you know, these shopping malls. And again, that's not for rich people. It's just for middle class people.
But also, I mean, people die earlier, or that's...
People die, Russian men die earlier, yeah.
Than before.
Well, now it's, thank God, it's going up again. But you see, you cannot talk about Russia. Russia is a huge country, you know, it has 10 time zones. It goes from China to Finland. So the cities is one Russia, and their life has become much, much better. You know, and not just Moscow, but I also, you know, we have offices in many cities. I go there, in offices, Bears, Perm, Nizhny Novgorod, Petersburg. Life has tremendously improved there. But in between there is this huge vastness with all these villages where life is horrible. They live like 1800. They live like the time of Tolstoy. And people are drunk day and night. So you cannot talk about Russia. You know, you have to define which part of Russia, you know?
Do you think that you got a connection with the poorer people? Do you know what they think? Do you know what they...
Well, not with these drunk people, no. I don't have any connection with them.
So, I mean, you feel any need to help them, maybe? Or to give more...
You give them more vodka? No, I don't know. No, you know... No, I feel connected to the young generation. You know, these people that have tremendous education. You know, education in Russia is very good. You know, in my office, people are between 20 and 30 years old. We, all our editors, all our, you know, the directors, the chief salespeople, they all speak English, French, Italian, very smart people. And that is the new Russia. And you know, that is that's my world, you know.
Do you still got a connection? I mean, you're still a member of the SP. Are you still a normal person? Do you go shopping for yourself? Do you know what a pack of milk costs?
I go shopping for, well, I, of course, you know, I don't shop every day. I hate shopping, but I don't shop every day here as well. So, but you know, if you take the metro in Moscow, like, you know, 5 million people every day take the metro. You know about the bombs that went off and, you know, terrible things happened. You know, I take the metro very often because of the traffic jams. And then you just see how prosperous Moscow is now. You just see how people are dressed, how they look. And, you know, it's every day, you know, they look almost better than they look in Amsterdam.
That's a very nice picture. That's a very promising
picture.
But who
is below the middle class then in the cities? Who is, if you speak of the middle class, there's someone below the middle class. There's a working class, there's unemployed, there's elderly, other homeless children in the metro too, but then not so conspicuous where the people get on the trains, but in the...
Of course there are poor people. I'm not saying there are no poor people. You know, come on, I mean, 20 years ago people had nothing. There was nothing. Literally, you know, when you went into a shop, the shop was empty. So, of course, there are still poor people. And especially the elderly people have completely missed the boat because of the, you know, when the country changed from a Soviet to a modern capitalist country, a lot of people suffered. There's no doubt about that. But it is in every time when such a revolution takes place, you know, and you can say a lot about Russia, but the reality is that for most people in Russia, life has improved tremendously.
In the cities.
That's what I said. You know, I'm not talking about the countryside where it's horrible, terrible, you know, you don't want to be there, but what can I do?
Everyone in the low and in the lower functions that will not probably have the chance to say they have RSE because then they get fired, they may not be so prosperous and happy as your employers are in the well-to-do functions, the ones with higher education.
But the
working class is disempowered.
Well, but you know, you're absolutely right. But that's not only in Russia; that's everywhere. You know, it's very unfair to point the fingers at Russia for that. In Holland, it's the same thing. In France or in Germany or everywhere. You know.
But it doesn't mean that everything that happens in Russia now is a blissful revolution.
Did I say that? I said it was a horrible, corrupt country. So I'm not saying that everything is great. What I'm saying is that if you're 20 years old, you live in a big city, the sky is the limit. There's so many opportunities, so many potential. You know, when I started living in Russia, all young people that came to me had one dream, and that is to go abroad. They wanted to go to America, they wanted to go to Europe, because they saw no future. Now they have one dream.
And the American dream?
No, now they have one dream, stay in Russia, and go on vacation to America. And that is a huge difference. You know, if I'm you know, my son is 21. All my kids went to Russian school. So they are completely Russian. They speak Russian between themselves. He studies in England now, but he wants to come back to Russia. Why? Because in Russia, the opportunities for young people are much bigger than they are here in Holland, for instance.
Does your son have the same opportunities as an average young person in Russia?
Well, listen, I mean, in life, life is not fair. So I'm not saying that everyone is happy in Russia. And in Holland, not everyone is happy. What I'm saying is if you are 20 years old, if you have done your school, and schools in Russia are very good, and it has nothing to do with rich schools or poor schools, if you go to and you've done your school successfully, and then you go to work, you have a lot of opportunities. You know, it's as simple as that.
Okay, we go back.
Are the schools, openbaar?
Yeah, so you have yeah, public schools. Yes, public schools.
Yeah.
And again, of course, you know, in if you live in a small village, the school is terrible because the teacher is drunk half of the time. But in Moscow and in Petersburg, and there's, you know, there's a very good school system. My kids go to schools in Russia. All our friends go to, some go to, you know, there's some private schools, but most are public schools. And the level of education is much higher than in here in Holland, no doubt. And, you know, they're very smart kids, you know. The Russians are very well-educated people. They're not very practical. You know, that's what we come in as Dutch people. We are, you know, practical people. We're not intellectual. Ask here anyone to recite a poem of Pushkin, and no one can do it.
I'm Russian.
Ah, well, you're a Russian.
Which one?
I cannot. I'm Dutch, but my kids can. You know, have a group like that in Russia, and even if half of them is taxi drivers, and they will all say, you know, which poem? I mean, you are Russian, you know it. So, you know, they have enormous, it's wonderful people.
Let's talk a little bit more about your company that you sold at some point in time. Independent Media was sold for 142 million euros in 2005. However, before it was sold, the company had its ups and its downs. And also with different patrons, like investors, according to changing power structures in the Kremlin. How did you deal with changes in the Kremlin? How did you deal with changes in power? Because, how did you deal with it?
Well, see, as I told already that Russia is a very corrupt country, and under Putin it only became more corrupt. So, but in the early 70s, the mafia was very active still. And they would come to your office and offer you protection, you know. We can help you.
Literally, someone came to you and
they would call you. Or, you know, I remember on a Sunday morning, a phone rings at the house, and the guy calls. This is Vladimir. You know,
Putin.
Vladimir. Not Putin. Hey, Vladimir. And I said, yeah, I know you. I said, fine. You have a blue Volvo, and you take this road every day to your office, and you have three boys in there, and this is this class, and this is where your office is, and I think you should talk to me. So I learned in Russia one thing, never be afraid. If you show fear, that's the end. So I said, fine, you know, let's talk. And so I went to the guy, and it was a scene out of The Godfather. These guys watch these movies too often, so they, they become like the Godfather, you know? So it was in a casino and girls with mini dresses and, you know.
They had dress up.
They had dresses, but, you know, very tiny. And then, you know, they start to threaten you and so on. But you just tell them to fuck off, you know?
What does it say? I mean,
well, that's what they said. You know, you need help. I said, I don't need help. Why do I need help?
But somebody, like a normal person in Moscow, I can imagine, if he says fuck off, and the next day he's lying dead on the street.
No, but that's a big misunderstanding.
You have reputation.
No, a lot of foreigners are afraid because fear is in their head.
But a lot of Russians are afraid too, and for a reason.
Yeah, but as a foreigner, you have an easier position because they are more careful with Russians than they are with foreigners. With foreigners than with Russians. So, you know, we have been threatened many times. You know, we have had some incidents. But I always said, you know, forget it. You know, don't do it. Once you do it, once you start in that direction, once they have one little part of your finger, then you're gone.
So all the power structures in Russia that changed over time, with new presidents and new people who were in power, actually none of them really affected you in a way.
No, no. So, but my philosophy was, instead of starting to pay someone, I'd rather had someone pay me. So what I did, from very early on, I always had a shareholder, minority shareholder, always like 10%, who was a big businessman.
Yeah. Mafia.
No mafia, big business people. So, you know, we had Khodorkovsky, who now is in jail, actually, was my first shareholder. And he is one of the best business people I've ever seen, and we support him very much with our newspaper. He's in jail because he got into a fight with Putin because he wanted to change Russia for the better. Very interesting, very smart guy. And he was my first shareholder.
Okay, let me get a little bit deeper exactly into this. In this Khodorkovsky, I don't know if I pronounced correctly, because he, to start Playboy and Cosmopolitan, you were held by him. He also returns as your first investor in another newspaper, Fedomosti, in 99. In 2003, Khodorkovsky, at the time, is Russia's most powerful oligarch and wealthiest man of Russia, has a fight with Putin, and then he's put in jail. Like the West depicts this arrest, this man, as a failing justice system, and which is controlled by Putin, and everybody says that this man is no much more guilty than any other businessman. But your newspaper, the Moscow Times, the person you just defended, your newspaper depicted him as an evil man.
No, not at all. No, the Moscow Times, infamously, the two newspapers I published, we have criticized every businessman when they do something wrong. But we have supported Khodorkovsky very much after he was arrested by the Russian government. No. Venomously is famous for all the from jail. Khodorkovsky writes articles, and we publish them in Venomously. We are the only ones who dare to do that now. So
when he was arrested, at the moment of arrest, didn't the Moscow Times write an article saying that he was a bad man?
No, never. What we have said, and that is true for every single Russian oligarch, is the way they earned their money is questionable. You know, Khodorkovsky is not a saint. You know, the problem in Russia is those very rich people all got their money by stealing it from the people. Because you cannot become a billionaire overnight, you know. When I met Khodorkovsky, he had nothing. He was dealing in second-hand computers. 5 years later, he was on the Forbes 100 in the world. You know that is not because he worked so hard in 5 years. So we wrote about those things. In fact, when he became a shareholder, I told him, dear Michiel, that's his name, we are going to keep writing critically about you and any other oligarch because we know you became so wealthy because you, basically stole a lot of companies.
But this man is able to steal and influence every company, but this one company, independent media, cannot be influenced by any wealthy Russian individual.
Yeah.
Content-wise, that
absolutely
you can say that.
Yeah. So, but earlier you said that, like, to be like successful to get rich, you have to be like corrupt and maybe.
No, I did not say that. I have to be corrupt. I
because adapt to the country.
Oh, no.
Other
no, no.
people.
No. There's a big difference. We have built our business ourselves. It's a huge difference. People who are rich in Russia are rich because of the minerals. They either have oil, or gas, or diamonds, or gold, or wood. Those people are rich in Russia. And those are resources that actually belong to the country. We come from a service industry. So we build up our own newspapers, our own magazines, by our own hands. And we did it, more or less successful. And that is how we made money.
So if,
huge difference.
So
you like independent journalism. If we look each other in the eyes, I mean, if I start digging in you, I mean, you've got a good press in the Netherlands, but if I start digging and go into Russia, talk with a lot of people, I won't find anything of connections with mafia or other that kind of thing.
Yeah, go ahead. You know, be my guest. You know,
but okay, how is it possible?
People have asked me that question 100 times.
I know. Nobody meant, but
in Russia. But do you think in Russia? I mean, wouldn't they write about it in Russia?
But then explain me, how is it possible that a lot of journalists, they were killed, and one of the famous examples is Anna Politkovskaya. And she was writing critical articles on Putin, on the Kremlin, and she had ideas about it, but a lot of people, she was killed, and 20 or 30 more other journalists, because they wrote critical about the Kremlin. But that you don't even live with the fear of being killed if you truly write critical.
Well, first of all, Anna was a journalist also for us. She was a columnist in the Moscow Times. So I knew her very well. And fear, as I said before, fear is in your heart, in your head. Fear is not, you know, with you, but within yourself. So, of course, there have been situations where we have been threatened and had problems, but I've never been afraid. You know, fear is a useless emotion. You either get killed or you don't get killed. Why then be afraid for it? I leave this building and the car drives me over. Should I be fear? Have fear for that? No.
What about your kids? I mean,
well, what about my kids? It's the same thing. I mean,
wouldn't mind.
No, of course you would mind. But you know, I believe in faith. You know, I'm a yoga person. I do every day 2 hours of yoga, and I believe in faith. You know, it happens or it doesn't happen. You know, and something comes to you, and you know.
But perhaps also, if you not really have a reason to fear, then you don't fear so much. But if you are threatened every day and terrible things happen to you, like you get beat up or your house or bombs are in your car, then you have more reason to fear. And these journalists experience this.
Listen, we live, you know, in a very privileged situation because we have the Moscow Times and Vedomosti, two very well-known newspapers. And people don't, and we are foreign, at least foreign owned. So they don't really want to touch us. But journalists, especially in the regions, in small newspapers, they have it much more difficult. Because they can be touched and no one will notice, you know. And we do help a lot of these newspapers in the regions. And, you know, for instance, there's a place just outside Moscow called Khimki. It's like a sort of the Balmamir of Moscow. And there's a small, very small local newspaper. And they started an action against the building of a new road through a forest. And the governor or the mayor of this place didn't like it. And first the editor-in-chief was beaten unconscious and he's still in coma. Then the deputy editor was shot, and those are the real heroes. You know, those people from small newspapers, you know, with maybe a circulation of 10,000, and you know, not a lot of money, no connections. They are, you know,
exactly. But this is, they can be touched,
right?
And you cannot be touched. But if you cannot be touched, it means maybe that there is like an invisible look, protection around you.
No, there's no protection. why should there be protection? I'm in a different position, you know. But that doesn't mean that there's a protection around me. You know, one of our editors was shot a couple of years ago. You know, thank God he survived. You know, photographers of ours were also beaten up. So it's not that we are immune, but we are more privileged. Because we are in Moscow, we make, you know, very prestigious newspapers, everyone knows us. So you know, why bother me, you know?
Okay. Maybe because of the time you should get to the situation.
If we go back to the Netherlands, people have given you all these nicknames, from Marxist to Millionaire, Peach Bell, Moscow, the Coup of Dirk Sauer. Are you proud of your reputation in the Netherlands?
I couldn't care less. you know, I'm not interested in reputation.
Okay. So and you came back in the Netherlands and you founded this publishing house, New Amsterdam, and you've bought NRC Media just recently. What was the atmosphere at the time in the media environment in Netherlands? What was going on?
Well, the media have a very difficult time. I don't know. Who reads the newspaper here?
So about reads how? NRC?
And who reads NRC? That's not enough. So the media has, it's difficult for newspapers, you know, and it's a stupid investment, actually, you know. If I wanted to make money, I should never put my money in a newspaper. But again, because I'm not interested in money, you know, I'm interested in newspapers, because I think they are very important, and we need to reinvent the newspapers so that it remains relevant also for people like you. And unfortunately, you don't read newspapers, so we have to find, you know, something to make you read newspapers.
Why do you think that people don't read newspapers, young people like us?
Well, it's a combination. First of all, of course, you know, I also would know more at the internet, but also because newspapers are still made exactly the same as 10 and 20 years ago. Newspaper people have become fat and lazy. I mean, not individual, because they work hard, but as an institution. The other day I met an important newspaper guy, and he said, newspapers had power, money, and arrogance. Now, they don't have power, they don't have money, but they still have the arrogance. And that is a little bit true for our industry. Again, I'm not talking about individual people, but the newspaper, you know, in the 70s, newspapers made so much money that they forgot to innovate, to come up with new concepts, new ideas. How can we make younger people read? You know, how do we distribute? You know, all these things.
All right, so you talk, I mean, we're all with young people here. How can you start to make them read newspapers? I mean, what are we going to change?
I don't know yet. I tell you honestly, this is what, you know, what I'm, that's why I'm now in Holland more, a little bit more, just to, you know, start working with the people of NSA to see what can we do to change this, you know. And maybe it's impossible. Maybe I'm like Don Quixote, you know, fighting against windmills. I don't know, but let's try. I have a passion for this. I think it's important. I even want to put my money in it, you know.
What will happen with a passionate man like you, who also happens to have a lot of money, changing media in Holland? What will happen?
I don't know. Let's see. I mean, in 5 years, we you know, people can say whether I was successful or not. You know, but in Holland, of course, immediately that's so interesting about Holland, because I've gone for 20 years, and then you come back, and then people immediately say that there's a capitalist coming, and you know, guys only in it for the money, or it's ridiculous. It's stupid, because it's a lousy investment. You know, if you really want to make money, you should buy gold, or you should, you know, do something else, but not go into newspapers. You know? So I do it because I believe in it. I think it's important, and I think it can be a business. It can be a business, but things have to change.
I find it really fascinating that you're so passionate about it, and also I've heard some of your interviews, and then I saw that you had some ideas about how you could combine media with newspapers, on television, and all those things together. But can you tell us a little bit about your vision, how this can happen in the future?
Well, I believe that
some concrete things like this can work.
Well, I believe that NSA is a not just a newspaper, but it's a brand. You know, that it stands for something, for a certain way of looking at the world. You know, and I say Handelsblad is aimed at people with an education who are interested in more than just the superficial. You know, everything is going faster, more sound bites, shorter, and I'm someone who likes do the analysis. I want to know why. I want to understand what's going on in the world, you know. That's why I started a book publishing company. That's why I started a television station, Het Gesprek, which probably is the most stupid, also stupid project from a financial point of view. But I like it. I think it's important that you can, you know, have a television station where you can actually take the time to talk about things. And I think long term, you will find that more and more people, not the mass, but that there is a group of people who are interested in the what and why, who are who want to take time to read or to listen and to understand what's going on. And that is what NSA can do, and I do believe in the combination with print, internet, television.
What kind of combination can we imagine?
Well, I mean, this.
I think you, I assume you have thought about that when you took it over. Well,
well, of course you think about it, but I don't have it's not. I have a ready plan. It doesn't work that way. That's what I told you. What my aim now is to find the best people again, and have a team. You know, because they have to do it. I cannot do it myself. Have a team that can really. You know, maybe it's too pretentious, but change a little bit the way we do the media now, you know? And you know, exactly how that will look like in 3 or 5 years, I just don't know.
And this is really your quality about so selecting the team, selecting the people, as you mentioned before. But what also a lot of people will be interested to know is the two people who recently stepped down from their position. What was your influence in this process?
Well, very very little.
But you just said that you were the guy who puts the team together.
Yeah.
So it sounds
sure. The new team I'm very involved in.
Right.
But it's not that I came in and I kicked out people. It doesn't work that way. You know, it was clear for that. You know, the perfect match wasn't there, you know. The perfect fit wasn't there. They were fighting on themselves, they were fighting with me. You know, I hate negative energy. Waste of time. You know, I only live once, you know. Why spend your time on fighting, you know? Don't do it, you know. If only work, when you're, you know, work should be fun. You know, when people come in my company in Moscow, they get a little book with the principles of the company. And our slogan in Russia, the motto of our company is fun and profit. Fun is the most important, because why do anything if it's not fun? I only do things that are fun. Because, you know, I only live once. But in order to have fun, you need profit. Because otherwise, always people are, you know, bothering you about bills you cannot pay and salaries you cannot pay. So you need the profit to have the fun.
So basically,
and that is how I see my life. You know?
Erger Donker was not making fun enough.
Well, it was not her as a person. You know, I've nothing against Birgit or anyone else there. You know, they're all great people. But somehow it's like in a marriage, you know. You know, with your wife it can click, and with someone else it cannot click, you know. And also between themselves it did not click. You know?
Is it important that you, as a shareholder,
It's like, you know, you can put 11 brilliant football players on the team, on the field, and you have no team. You know how it works. You cannot, you know, somehow there has to be the chemistry. And if the chemistry isn't there, then it won't work.
Do you let them? I see that we also have a question from the audience.
I have a little question about, not about your personnel, but about your business partners, about Egeria, the familie Brenningmeijer. I believe you wrote an article as a New Review reporter about the familie Brenningmeijer, which was very critical.
Yeah, absolutely.
How was it to work with them?
Well, it's a big, you know, the press in Holland is extremely sloppy and bad. So everyone wrote that the familie Brenningmeijer had invested in LSA Handelsblad.
No, I know Egeria is a little bit more than only the family of
Brenningmeijer. No, it's not a little bit more. It's the familie Brenningmeijer has nothing to do with the investment in NSA. The family Brenningmeijer, famous Dutch family, was one of the co-founders of Egeria, but they have left this group a long time ago. They're not even part of it anymore. So, you know, but even so, even if they were, fine, you know, that would be really ironic. It would be really fun, actually. Because I've written many critical articles about this family.
So, you didn't have any question asked about that article from the family or anything? Just to make a laugh.
I told Egeria, you know, okay. I'm the guy who wrote all these articles about Brenningmeijer. Yeah.
Okay.
This afternoon there's going to be a new chief editor chosen by NRC.
No, not this afternoon.
Because you're
who told you?
You're here.
No, that's a process that is going on.
Right, because people from NRC. Say I wanted to come, but they said, "Oh, we're gonna choose a new."
Maybe they do it without you.
Well, maybe they will talk about choosing a new label, but there's not yet.
Do you know a good person who would be a good chief?
Of course, I know many good people. But you know, that's up to the team that is sitting there now. We have wonderful people there, and you know, I'm sure that we'll be okay.
It's up to them, but there has to be a click with you.
Of course, but that's normal.
I have a question about the process of putting the players together, so to speak. How does it work? Do you see a few persons that are talented, and then you let them decide themselves who fits with them, or?
Absolutely.
That's how it goes.
I have 40 magazines. And 2 newspapers. It's impossible to manage that all yourself. So, in my company, people have huge responsibilities. They basically, it's their own thing. You know, it's like they run it. You know, as long as everything is going fine, I don't care how they run it. You know, some magazines we have Esquire, which is a very popular magazine, very critical magazine in Russia. It's really sort of very intellectual, anti-Putin. And during the day, there's never anyone at this office. It's always empty. And when I'm in the office, there's no one there. And they start at 11 at night. And they work till God knows when. And they, you know, how they do it, I don't know. And I don't care. As long as it's a successful magazine, fine. You know, work in the mornings or nights or in the weekend or not.
How do you select the good players? If we go back to the Holland situation, you want to bring a team together, right? A team of talented people. How far in detail will you go in selecting those players? Will you just go for
only
one or two key
people.
Ones?
Only the top
a few key people, and they can decide for themselves what happens around it.
I'm way too lazy for them.
Okay.
That's maybe for the last.
Yeah, for our last question. That's a funny one. Once I read somewhere that evolution is when change happens gradually, and revolution is when it happens disruptive. In Dutch media now, are you that revolution?
No, I used to be a revolutionary, but I became a very peaceful guy, you know.
a rich, powerful guy.
No,
you
no,
became actually greater, more powerful.
No, no, no. I'm more and more turning inward. You know, I'm more and more, you know, because of all this yoga that I do and meditation and stuff. I'm more and more relaxed. You know.
Do you have any advice for any entrepreneurial students sitting around here who want to make it? Like,
don't be afraid. You know, there's only one thing in life. You know, don't be afraid. Just do it and make mistakes. When I hire someone, the first thing I say, I want you to make mistakes. The more, the better. Because if you make mistakes, it means that you have initiative and. Only from mistakes you can learn. Because I've done a lot of things completely wrong. You know, I've made a lot of mistakes. In fact, I think of every decision, 50% is right, 50% is wrong. It doesn't matter. Because at least I made 50% right decisions. And that is the essence of life, you know.
Well, with that, I think that I speak on behalf of everybody that we would like to thank you for coming here to the University of Amsterdam. And let's give Dirk Sauer a big round of applause.